Hello all, in this video we are going to see what to write in recommendations for clinico-social case of diabetes mellitus. Before going to the recommendations in a clinico-social case, we should understand what is the major difference between a clinical case and a clinico-social case. There are three key differences, rather additions to the clinical case. That is, we add social aspects of the disease, that is, we include environmental history, social history, in order to make it as a clinico-social case. Secondly, we try to identify the cause of the disease and try to suggest the prevention and control measures for the particular disease. Thirdly, we give recommendations not only to the individuals but also to the family and the community. Here is the list of clinico-social cases which will be kept in community medicine practicals. Here I have given 10 cases. 99% of the times you will get one among these cases. This list can be divided into 5 pairs, that is the non-communicable pair, diabetes mellitus and hypertension, MCH maternal and child health, MCH pair, that is antenatal case and postnatal case, the pediatric pair, ARI and ADD or diarrhea, the chronic illness pair, tuberculosis and leprosy, then the miscellaneous pair, dengue or any fever for evaluation, or HIV. These cases, the availability of the cases from antenatal care to HIV will be less during exams. The chance of students getting diabetes mellitus and hypertension is more, that is almost about half of the times you will either get a case of diabetes mellitus or hypertension, or a case of some other clinico-social case who has, in addition to this disease, they have diabetes mellitus and hypertension. So before writing the recommendations of clinico-social case, we should have this in mind, that we are going to give recommendations not only to the individual but also to the family and the community level. Then the other things which we should keep in mind is the levels of prevention. That is primary prevention, secondary prevention and tertiary prevention. In primary prevention, we have population strategy and high-risk strategy. And in primary prevention, the modes of the interventions are health education and specific protection, or health promotion and specific protection. Secondary prevention, the modes of interventions are early diagnosis and prompt treatment or adequate treatment. And in tertiary prevention, we have disability limitation and rehabilitation. In specific to diabetes mellitus, we are going to deal in this presentation. So here we have to write recommendations in this headings. That is, at individual level, we have to give recommendations for the relief of symptoms, diet, exercise, self-care, adherence to the medication, general information, monitoring of disease, and family level and community level recommendations. At individual level, the first is the relief of the symptoms. If suppose he has got some complaint for getting admitted in the hospital, then we should treat that symptom first. For example, paresthesia or any wound or any fever, superadded infections or any signs of complications, then we have to give medicines to control the symptoms. Then the second is treating the comorbidities and any drug interactions if the patient has. Then the third thing is, we should check for the blood sugar control using the blood sugar and HbA1c, and this blood sugar monitoring is a separate heading in individual level recommendation which will be dealt later. Diet is very important in case of a diabetes mellitus patient. Based on the literacy level of the patient, we can explain some of these basic concepts. Otherwise, we have to keep this in mind and recommend to the patient in a way that the patient can understand easily. So first thing is, the patient should take a low glycemic index food and also a low calorie food. We all know calorie is just the energy which a food can yield, but glycemic index is the ability of the food to how fastly increase the blood sugar level. That is called as the glycemic index. Some food like potato will have low calorie but has high glycemic index. That is, if 100 gram of rice yield about 350 kilocalories, the rate at which it increases the blood sugar will be very less. But 100 grams of potato will yield only 60 kilocalories, but it increased the blood sugar level very fast. So high glycemic index should be avoided, such as sweets, bread, rice, potato have high glycemic index, and we should recommend low calorie foods. Then the whole grains can be preferred. Fruits with edible skin has low glycemic index and high fiber content when compared to the fruit juices. We have to recommend the patient to eat in a small quantities at frequent interval. Small frequent meal is a key factor in case of diet recommendation for a diabetes mellitus patient. Then reduce the consumption of the oil, especially the oil which has more saturated fats. Then reduction of fried foods and bakery items. And the patient should aim for at least 5 servings of vegetables and fruits per day. Alcohol should be avoided. The concept of empty calorie is each gram of alcohol liberates about 4 kilocalories as equal to your carbohydrate or a protein. Then for a diabetic patient, no fasting is advisable and no feasting is. Then the third important thing in diabetes mellitus recommendation is exercise. We have to advise the patient based on the BMI of the patient to make a weight loss or weight maintenance based on the BMI. Then we have to recommend aerobic exercise like walking, cycling and swimming. The basic difference between aerobic exercise and anaerobic exercise is aerobic exercise does not hold your breath. It makes you breathe more while doing that exercise. That is good for diabetes mellitus patients. And this brisk exercise should be a target of about 30 to 45 minutes per day in most of the days of the week. Then other types of exercise which can be recommended is bodybuilding like weightlifting, yoga, meditation for stress relief, upper body exercise in case knee pain is there. Then the fourth important thing in case of the diabetes mellitus recommendation is the self-care, that is the personal hygiene. The patient has to take a daily bath, should wear clean clothes and trim their nails in order to avoid the ingrown nails. Then they should avoid injuries. For the foot care, they should examine their feet every day for cracks, swellings, callosities, redness, increased temperature or ingrown nail or loss of sensation. They should keep their interdigital spaces dry by using the towel and dusting powder if necessary. Use of mirror or a person can help. So in this image we can see that hygiene, always keep your feet clean, dry the feet especially in between the fingers. Then we have to check for cracks, swellings, callosities, redness, increased temperature, ingrown nails with our naked eyes. If possible, we have to use a mirror or we can ask a person for help. We should always seek help of the medical care professional. The fifth important point in case of the recommendation of diabetes mellitus is the adherence to the medication. Diabetes mellitus patients have to take the medicines at time and adequate medicine, not to change their dosage without the doctor's advice. If they are on insulin, they should correctly follow the procedure and dosage. Then the general information which they should know is about the symptoms of the hypoglycemia, that is sweating, giddiness, headache, fainting, and glycosuria and complications of the diabetes mellitus. They should carry sweets and snacks in order to avoid the symptoms of hypoglycemia. Then they should carry a card always with the details of the patient name, address, phone number and about the disease and the prescribed medicine. And they should avoid tobacco usage in any form. The last most important individual recommendation for diabetes mellitus is monitoring the diabetes mellitus investigations. Every day, patient has to do a foot examination with or without the help of a mirror and with or without a person. Home glucose monitoring can be advised weekly, and every month fasting and postprandial should be taken. BP measurement, weight measurement should be taken every month. Then every 3 months HbA1c should be taken. Every 6 months HbA1c if sugar levels are under control. And every year they should do an electrocardiogram, lipid profile, serum creatinine, urine microalbuminuria and fundus examination in order to foresee the microvascular and macrovascular complications of the diabetes mellitus. Then the family level, We should insist on the importance of the diet, exercise, proper follow-up in controlling blood sugar and preventing further complications. Importance of diet monitoring, as it is better to avoid more sweet and oily foods in the diet of the patient. Screening to be done for other family members. So the diet, exercise and proper follow-up should be insisted for the patient among the family members. Then the next is the community level recommendation. We should do a health education about the risk factors of the diabetes mellitus among the community. And this community level recommendation should target the high-risk groups, that is people over the age of 45 years, obese people, family history of diabetes mellitus, history of gestational diabetes, pre-diabetics, hypertensive patients, female with baby weighing more than 3.5 kg, females with excess weight gain in pregnancy. All these has to be considered as high-risk groups. Lifestyle modifications, including primordial prevention among adolescents, that is the removal of the risk factors among the adolescents. Then importance of adherence to the medications, diet, exercise and food care for those who are diagnosed with diabetes mellitus. Knowledge regarding the symptoms and complications of diabetes mellitus. So before we ending the presentation, we are going to see the commonly asked questions while presenting a clinico-social case pro forma of diabetes mellitus. What is diabetes mellitus? So the key points about diabetes mellitus is, diabetes mellitus is a state of chronic hyperglycemia caused by defective production or action of insulin, which on a long term result in number of complications, which includes cardiovascular, renal, neurological, ocular and others such as intercurrent infections. So the key words here is that diabetes mellitus is a heterogeneous group of disease. Now the next question is, what is the classification of the diabetes mellitus? We should know this table to answer classification of diabetes mellitus. WHO classifies diabetes mellitus into three types, that is diabetes mellitus, impaired glucose tolerance and gestational diabetes mellitus. Among diabetes mellitus, type 1 diabetes mellitus are insulin dependent. Here there is insulin deficiency. Type 2 are non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, where insulin resistance is the most common cause. Then malnutrition related diabetes mellitus. Then other types include secondary to pancreatic, hormonal, drug induced, genetic and other abnormalities. Then the next question is, what are the screening tests used for diabetes mellitus? Here urine for sugar, blood sugar test will be the answer. Then what is impaired glucose tolerance and what is impaired fasting glucose? So to answer this, we should know this table. And we can forget about this millimoles, which is not commonly used in our settings. Fasting plasma glucose is more than 126, then we say diabetes. If the 2-hour plasma glucose is more than 200, then we say diabetes. Impaired glucose tolerance is the fasting plasma glucose less than 126 and 2-hour plasma glucose is between 140 to 200 milligrams. Impaired fasting glucose is if the 2-hour plasma glucose is less than 140 milligrams but the fasting blood sugar is between 110 to 125, then we call it as impaired fasting glucose, and this is impaired glucose tolerance. When 2-hour is more, then we call it as impaired glucose tolerance. When fasting is more, then we call it as impaired fasting glucose. Then what is HbA1c? HbA1c is glycosylated hemoglobin. It gives a idea of long-term glucose control. It reflects the mean glucose level during the red cell lifetime. What is syndrome X? Syndrome X is characterized by hyperglycemia, hyperinsulinemia, dyslipidemia and hypertension, called as metabolic syndrome. What are the complications of the diabetes mellitus? When we are answering complications of diabetes mellitus, we have to answer by dividing it into microvascular and macrovascular complications. Microvascular complications include, which involve eye, kidney and nerves, causing retinopathy, nephropathy and neuropathy respectively. In macrovascular complications, the organs affected are brain, heart and the extremities, which causes stroke or transient ischemic attack and heart attacks and the peripheral vascular disease respectively. And what are all the common oral hypoglycemic agents? So this, for this answer, we have metformin from the biguanides. Then among insulin secretagogues, in sulfonylureas, we have glibenclamides, glipizide, glyclazide, glimepiride. And glinides, we have ripaglinide and natiglinides, thiazolidazones, pioglitazone, sodium glucose co-transport 2 inhibitors, alpha-glucosidase inhibitors, acarbose, glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor agonist, dipeptidyl peptidase 4 inhibitors. So out of which, this insulin secretagogues causes the risk of hypoglycemia. So we should know the advantages and at least one disadvantages of these drugs. What are all the host factors leading to diabetes mellitus? Age, gender, genetic factors, genetic markers, especially with the type 1, we have HLA, DR3 and D4, which is powerfully associated with type 1 diabetes mellitus. HLA B8 and HLA B15 are also associated with type 1 diabetes mellitus. Then obesity, maternal diabetes are all the host factors that can lead to diabetes mellitus. What are all the environmental factors that lead to diabetes mellitus? Sedentary lifestyle with lack of exercise, diet with saturated fat intake and less dietary fiber intake, malnutrition in the childhood, excessive alcohol intake, viral infections, chemical agents and stress are all the environmental factors that can lead to diabetes mellitus. Then this question number 12, 13, 14 and all we have discussed in the individual level recommendations. Then what are all the high risk groups for screening diabetes mellitus? People with sedentary lifestyle, obesity, who are on oral contraceptives, smoking, high blood pressure, elevated cholesterol and triglyceride levels. What are all the treatment available for gestational diabetes mellitus? The answer here is the insulin and oral hypoglycemic agents are contraindicated in gestational diabetes mellitus. What is hypoglycemic index? As I told earlier, glycemic index is an index for the food material. The ability of the food material to fastly raise the blood sugar is called as glycemic index, irrelevant of the calorie. That is glycemic index. Some foods like potato will have less calorie but high glycemic index. That is, it raises the blood sugar level very fast when consumed. There are some food items like rice, wheat and all will have high calorie, but the rate at which it increases the blood sugar level will be very less. Hence, the glycemic index is also less. So that's all about recommendations for clinico-social case of diabetes mellitus. Thanks for watching this video.